Don't do anything ridiculous. Cheers.
Cheers.
It's a good old-fashioned interview. Any excuse to drink on a rooftop in Miami. Adam, everyone.
Ashley.
That's me.
Thanks for having me.
No, thanks for coming on. I love this, all right? Adam, you are a musician who has worked with many amazing musicians. A Shark fan probably know you best with your work with Mattis Yahoo.
Yeah.
You two went on the road for what, like 5 years?
Yeah, I did all of his acoustic shows for about 5 or 6 years. Played a lot of shows down here.
What do they call you? A finger style guitarist?
Yeah, that's the promotional terminology, I think, just to differentiate me from the electric guitar players. A lot of right hand work.
Well, it definitely, after Googling, I realized, even the thought of it gives you more of an idea of the sound you're getting into.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very Mattis Yahoo, laid back fish, Dave Matthews vibe.
Yep.
I think that you bring to the table.
Uh-huh. I would agree.
Definitely the new record, or Laugh, Cry, Grief, Hope.
Yeah, that's the record.
Out May 19th.
May 13th.
Oh, May 13th.
Show's May 19th.
Okay. Yeah. Album's coming out before then.
Yeah.
Ooh, feelings?
Yeah, yeah. I'm like a chicken with my head cut off trying to figure out what, I mean, I have the Regime Music Group, which is the label that's putting it out.
Okay.
So they have, these two amazing women have been helping me, and I think I would have had like a mental breakdown without them because it's been like 20 years since I've seriously put out my own music.
Okay.
So I'm just like running around trying to get everything done.
A lot of hand-holding, a lot of refocusing.
Yes, exactly.
Well, it's kind of funny. That's really where the album came from, is you muddling through a very hard period in your life. Do you comfortable talking about?
Yeah, of course, 100%.
All right.
So I love talking about it, actually.
What inspired? How did this album come about, then?
Sure. So in like summer-ish of 2019, we had like a bunch of family kind of trauma stuff. Like, my youngest son had developed a seizure disorder, which was, thank God, short-lived. My mom had emergency surgery that put her in the ICU, and she was in the ER, like, off and on for a bunch of months, and that scared the heck out of all of us. And then, sadly, my brother-in-law, who my wife and I have been together and or dating since we were 16, and I'm 42 now.
Oh, goodness.
So my brother-in-law was a very close part of our, you know, family and friendship and all that, and he sadly passed away suddenly.
Oh.
And this all happened between, like, July and August, those three things. So apparently I wasn't mentally equipped to deal with those things.
Who would be mentally equipped to deal with them? Nobody has enough tools in their box to handle that.
Right, I didn't have a toolbox. I was just like, you know, staying up all night trying to be helpful and whatever. And the bottom line was I ended up needing help, you know, to get through all of that. And my therapist, and I highly recommend having a therapist for all things.
You're here.
I can sit to that. She gave me this sort of like creative task that she wanted me to play. I wasn't playing guitar. I kind of gotten too depressed and just wasn't really using the guitar as a healing tool. And she wanted me to play every night, even if I was just improvising or just kind of noodling around, but just to make sure I was doing things that were healthy for me and creative for me. And she told me I had to, like, in my voice memos on my phone, record it, even if it was just 2 or 3 minutes, and send it to her as proof. So she was holding me accountable.
Oh.
And if I didn't send it to her by midnight, I'd get a text, where's your playing tonight?
Ooh.
So I did
like
that.
Her.
Yeah, she's amazing. And I did it for many months. And what happened was, as you're doing that night after night, I'd stuff, I started writing lyrics seriously for the first time since like college.
Mm.
And so I had these improvisations I was doing every night. I had these kind of journaling that I was doing. And then
we're building an album.
Right. So then within like 3 months of doing it, I had like 30 songs. So then I met with a friend of mine down here, Arturo Garcia, who great musician down here, who co-produced the record with me. And we started working through them, say, hey, this is an album, let's flush these out. This song could have horns, this song could have strings, this song could be solo, this song could be with a 7-piece band. And then COVID hit,
of course, we
did nothing, like everybody.
Yes, again.
But creatively, we kept working on the songs, Arturo and I, and kept fleshing them out. And then, you know, we actually recorded the record down here with DJ The Spam, the Spam All-Stars studio, which was great, and did that during COVID, all masked up, you know, recording. And now, you know, I pitched it around. I was able to get label support, which I'm insanely grateful for. I didn't expect that to happen. So now I have an album, and I gotta do something with it.
I love the serendipity that this album comes from you finding the tools for your tool belt, you know, learning how to deal with grief, and it's dropping right here in the middle of Mental Health Awareness Month.
Like, that's correct.
Did you plan that?
No, absolutely not.
So it is serendipity.
And I will tell you that I take, like, mental health is a big, I before I got into the music industry, touring with Matt Desiahu and Andrea Bocelli and some other people, I was in graduate school for cognitive psychology, and I dropped out. But it's kind of all my free time reading was that, which so I also, when all this stuff happened to us, I felt like, I can deal with this. Like, I studied this stuff.
Right.
But it turns out, like, studying and practicing are very different things.
For sure.
And that was a hard lesson in that.
Well, and when it comes to applying those lessons to yourself.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's so much easier to give advice to people when you're looking away from the distance. Correct. Versus having to look at yourself.
Yeah, and I think there's a great, famous, you know, Nobel Prize winning psychologist, Daniel Kahneman. Up, incredible thinker, obviously, you know, won a Nobel Prize, but he discovered, he and his partner who passed away, discovered all these heuristics, which were like sort of irrational things that we do when we're dealing with life.
Right.
And he always says, which I find so amazing and humbling, is he says, even though I have discovered these things through research, I am no better at protecting myself against these irrational choices than anyone else.
That's right.
So it's a hard lesson, but yeah, until I got an automatic text message from CVS the other day that said, this is national, you know, mental health awareness, I was like, oh, I didn't know that. Thanks, CVS.
No, man, it was meant to be. See, it was meant to be. This album has something a little different. I don't think it's unusual. I think it's creative. It comes with a 32-page illustrated book.
Yeah.
Done by a pretty well-renowned artist named Mel Marcello.
Marcello.
I can't pronounce names, but anybody who listens to the program already knows that.
That's fine.
He's a legendary San Diego digital illustrator. How did the concept come about? How are you like, you know what, I want to attach images to this music?
So Mel and I have been friends for a long time. Sadly, Mel just passed away.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it's sad. In the first weekend of March, she had a heart attack. Anyways, yeah, it's crazy. The whole thing's crazy, but I've been in touch with his sister, and Mel was a grace, but I met him through working with Andrea Bocelli. He had made this incredible poster. He used to be a poster artist at the arena in San Diego, the old sports arena there.
Very cool.
And whoever came through,
what a job.
You know, Chili Peppers, Bad Bunny, whoever, he was hired by the arena to make a unique piece of art for the band and give it as a gift. So for Bocelli, who's blind, he made this insane, like, digital profile drawing of him that was, like, half, like, 60s Bill Graham, you know, hippie-ish with, like, modern pop graphic art.
Oh, cool.
And he did the whole thing in Braille so that Bocelli, and raised Braille so Bocelli could feel it and know what the poster was about. So Mel's poster was immediately framed and put in their house in Miami.
Oh, very cool.
So it was clear, like, oh, they, like, this gift they really love. And everyone in the room when Mel presented it was like, you're the best. You won. Like, you won gift giving.
Well, because it's thoughtful.
Yeah.
It's specific.
Yeah.
It's like what he does.
Yeah.
So you reach out to him and
I'm like, can you do that
on
for me?
I would like a 3D rendering of myself playing guitar
that's right.
32 times.
That's right. We decided on a book. I thought it'd be, you know, trying to be realistic about people don't necessarily know who I am, and I got to really sell this. So what's another sort of like entry point for people to be interested in what's going
show
on?
What I do.
Exactly. And Mel was just super into it, and he was like, I'll make a drawing for every song you have. And I have like hundreds of sketches. We would send ideas to each other, and then he went, what do you think about this? Yeah, that's great. How about we change this element? And then, you know, it was COVID. Like, I was in no rush.
And he needed something to do. Yeah. Everybody needed something to do.
And it was great.
So, album out, book out. I know we got a vinyl going.
Like, yes.
You are steamrolling, heading towards the bridge. And that's literally what's happening. That's the big album release party. Like, essentially, this is going to be the accumulation of all of these small things that you've been dropping.
Correct.
And because you already have released Quiet, Ways of Man, and Drifting Through.
Yeah.
Beautiful,
Thank
by
you.
The way. And I'm serious, very Dave Matthews Fish. And the Bridge is a great venue. It's a small, wonderful place to go and sit down and discover artists and music, and I highly recommend.
Thank you.
And so you're a little nervous, but totally excited.
Yeah, I'm super psyched. And I got like the electric guitar player I've toured with, who's been with Matt Desiahu forever, for 20 years. So he's a close friend of mine, obviously. We played together for so long. So I'm flying him in. He's going to play lead.
Oh, man.
Arturo, the guy who co-produced the records, playing drums. He helped me with all the horn charts. So we have a horn section. Dion Kerr, an incredible bass player from South Florida, who's in the Smoogies and 12 Eyes Trio. He's playing bass on it. So it's a great band.
I did read somewhere that you were going to have some, I don't know, maybe on this album? Have you talked about who will be making appearances in between songs and maybe on some songs? Or are you still keeping that a secret?
I mean, some of it's, I mean...
You can tell me a little.
Yeah, so, I mean, you know, that guy that I toured with?
Yeah, that guy. So, I know that guy.
You know, he got famous for, he got famous for a lot of reasons, but... You know, he's quite the beatboxer.
For sure he is. It's hard to spell his name, and he knows that he's Mike, you know?
That's right. That's right. So so there's a little bit of that happening.
All right.
You know, yeah, it's... There's that. The horn section on the record itself are just incredible players. A guy named Jesse McGinty, you guys can look him up. He's done horn arrangements from everyone from, like, Kanye to Jay-Z to, like...
good at what he does.
Kind of. I mean, he's only able to do this record for me because he was friends with Arturo, and it was like COVID, like, hey, let's call the best guy we know and ask for a favor. It's one of those, like you said, serendipitous, but during COVID, people needed stuff to do.
Right.
So I took advantage of it.
Well, and it was a therapeutic process, and everybody was going through some kind of therapeutic process during those moments.
Yeah.
Now, I have it on a little bit of authority that you might...
I'll play a tune.
I see a guitar.
Yeah.
I'm thinking...
I just brought it for my acting years, holding it.
Well, I didn't know if that's... If you had to travel with a guitar in order to be a musician, if that was, like, part of the criteria.
That'd be really funny if that's how we all behave.
Yeah, because if you're not... Right, you're
like
not a guitarist.
Like, obnoxious, self-conscious musicians.
You have to always be prepared for your job.
Everyone needs to know at all times.
I have headphones and a mic constantly.
I think that a lot, actually. Like, sometimes I'm on tour and I look at, like, the people I'm with and I'm like, if we weren't holding instruments, people would just think we were homeless people.
Yes, they would. Most people just think I talk a lot.
So they'd be like, those poor guys. look at their shirts. They have holes in their shirts.
I wish they had guitars so I could put some change inside their cases.
Their soles are falling off their shoes. Oh, they're holding a guitar. They must be a musician. Oh, never mind.
That makes sense now. Yeah. I understand the
But
look.
Yes, I'd play a song if you would like me to.
All right, we're going to drink a drink and then we're going to play a song.
Can you play and drink at the same time?
That'd be really funny. We all throw our hands up.
If you like this, like, let's hop on it.
Yeah.
Date night fun. Thanks again so much.
Thank you so much, Ashley.